In the previous video, we validated the point of view project by doing a simple loopback with no hardware to get in the way. In this video, we'll add the PC's network interface card into the loop to verify that we can access the project using local hardware, still using the NT web server we used in the last video. Once we have that working, is there any reason we can't access this point of view app remotely using the NT web server? Well, no, not at all. So we'll go ahead and do that too, but beware, this is only to get us up and running quickly for testing. You don't want to use the NT web server in your final app because it doesn't support all of point of view's features, and most importantly, it's not secure. You would be exposing your system to all kinds of threats. In the last video of this series, we'll show you how to set up the Microsoft IIS server, which is recommended for use with point of view. To do all of this, you'll need to know the IP address of this PC. Now we could go to the command prompt, do an IP config, and read the IP address there. But instead, we're going to use a point of view function to get the IP address just to show you another one of point of view's powerful features. If your project's still running from the last video, go ahead and stop it. Open the main screen and add a text box like this, then double click to get to the properties. Click this button to get to the tag database. In here we have the project tags, the system tags, and we have the function list. This is a fantastic feature of the point of view software. There are tons of functions built in for you to use. Math, statistics, date and time, Windows control, graphics, etc. We want the system functions, so I'll double click on that. In this group, you can find the path to your app, cursor location, screen resolution, Mac ID, computer name, etc. We want the computer's IP address, so we select this one. And this doesn't have to be a tag by itself, it can be an expression. Let's add some text with an open quote, computer IP, colon, space, end quote, and a plus sign. That concatenates the text and the result returned by the function. Make sure you disable this input enabled box. This isn't a text box that expects user input, we're just displaying a text result. Close that and run the app, and sure enough, we get the computer's IP address. So take a look at this huge list of functions. There's lots of things there that can make your applications more powerful and your life more easy. Okay, given the computer's IP address, we only need to do one thing. Under the Project tab, click on the web icon and put that IP address here in place of the loopback address we had before. Everything else should already be set up from the previous video, so just hit OK. And remember, anytime you do anything in the web dialog, we change the IP address, make sure you go to the Home tab and hit Verify. It verifies the project, but it also creates all the associations needed to link the new IP address to the HTML files. And of course, since we changed the screen, we need to go to the Point of View button and hit Publish, Save All as HTML to update those HTML files with the changes we made. So all we did was get the computer's IP address and change the IP address of the server. Well, let's try it. Make sure the NT web server is still running and hit the Run button. If we bring up Internet Explorer and point it to the new IP address, we get the expected result. We can view and control the app remotely via the browser. Perfect. But we're still on the local PC. Let's do the same thing, but from a real live remote PC. Before we do that, there's one thing we need to do on the remote client PC before we can point the browser to our app. A lot of the graphics and controls are stored locally on the client PC. That way the server can simply command the client to display a certain graphic rather than transfer the entire graphic each and every time. That makes the client a lot more responsive. To set that up, you just go to the point of view installation on the runtime PC, and in the bin folder, you'll find an executable called thin client setup. Get a copy of that and put it on the client PC and run it. Great. We changed the IP address of the runtime app, and we set up the thin client on the remote PC. Now we can point our remote PC's browser to the app, and uh-oh, what happened? Well, I only have one thin client license on this setup. And since I have a client running on the local runtime machine, I can't open another client remotely. So let's close that local runtime client to free up that license and refresh the remote client. And just like that, we're now monitoring and controlling the app on a true remote PC. So all we really did in this video was change the IP address of the server and set up the thin client. Easy. In the next video, we'll set up the Microsoft IIS server and do it all again. If you have any questions, please don't hesitate to call Automation Direct's free, award-winning tech support during regular business hours. They'll be happy to help you. And don't forget the forums. There are lots of folks there that love to share their years of experience. Just don't post any support questions there. Automation Direct support staff doesn't monitor the forums on a regular basis.